just to put just a small addition to what John said, Molly and I attended the marriage seminar a couple of years ago, and we were excited to be here. We wanted to hear what Michael Bowes had to say, but there was sort of a thinking that we've been married 44 years, and so we wondered, what is he going to add? And, you know, what kind of information does he give that's going to spread across an audience of young couples, middle-aged couples, and older couples? But I assure you, the information that he gave and the way that they were able to communicate the message of marriage and home was superlative. They did an excellent job, and I guarantee you, you will absolutely enjoy hearing and being a part of that evening. And so please, again, I encourage you to sign up. Father, I thank you for the time that we have together, and I pray that what we would do here in the remaining moments would be important for us, that we look back on it and say it's been a good time to be together. And I pray that you will allow what I'm going to say to be said in a way that makes sense, and that you will allow me to keep my mind on what I'm saying and guide the words, and that through this, your truth will be exposed, that will challenge us to be better people. To that end, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, back in August of 1992, Hurricane Andrew came sweeping ashore, leaving in its wake a massive pathway of destruction, making it second only to the 205 Katrina in terms of damage, estimated to be about $25 billion. Well, in the aftermath, city officials wanted to know why the destruction was so devastating, in spite of the fact that codes for building had been passed stipulating that homes in that region should be able to withstand winds up to 120 miles per hour. And so they began an investigation, and here's what they found. That during the 1980s building boom, many of the contractors simply didn't follow code. They cut corners. They performed shoddy work. And they left the homeowners to bear the brunt of the storm. Now, there was one notable exception. There was a community of homes built by Habitat for Humanity that, other than damage from flying debris, came through the storm with only relative and minor damage. Now, of course, they wanted to know why. And so they tracked down Habitat for Humanity officials and said, why do you think your home survived the storm when homes around you didn't? Now, listen to this response by one of the officials. I think it sums it up well. We make a commitment to these families to provide a simple, decent home. We do not cut corners. We do not build to meet the minimum requirements of code. We build what we feel is a good house. It exceeds codes. We've been studying the life of Abraham. God gave him a set of building codes. And he said, go build your life of faith. And by the end of his life, we could call him the great father of all the faith. So he followed God's guidelines. He became a great man. And that's faith under construction. He had some storms in life, but he had strong faith and he survived them. Now, he walked along with one man for an extended period of time, who also had faith in God. Their paths, though separated, they diverged. They really never came together again. And while Abraham would go on with his wonderful great life of faith, this other would choose to cut corners. He would choose to do some shoddy workmanship. And when a great storm came, his life and his home were blown apart. I want to invite you to walk with me, and I want you to examine with me the house that Lot built. For I think as you examine it and what happened to it, it will provide, I hope, some encouraging and some challenging words for all of us as we consider the homes that we're building, that we're going to live in personally for our lives, and that which we'll be taking our families and living in also. You know the man, Lot. He's Abram's nephew. Lot's dad, which was brother after Abram, he died. Apparently his wife did too, because eventually Lot ends up in the care of Abram and Sarah, and they join him in this trip to the land of promise. And over the course of time, they began to do exceedingly well. In fact, the Bible says that Lot was moving with Abram, also had flocks and herds and tents. And in fact, they're doing real well. They're growing and they're multiplying. But it says, now Lot, who was moving about Abram, also had tents and herds and flocks, of course. But the tent, but the land, could not support them while they stayed together, for their possessions were so great that they were not able to stay together. And quarreling arose between Abram's herdsmen and the herdsmen of Lot. The Canaanites and the Perizzites were also living in the land at that time. Now, it is said that in Palestine, water is more important than oil. Because you see, there will be an extended period of time of drought, no rain. And when you've got so many and so much competing for the same resources, then these quarrels would develop. Now, it's important, I think, as we begin this journey, to understand something. Lot is a good man. The faith that Abraham placed into his life and heart, he passed on to Abram. To Lot, and Lot became a believer. Now, we know this from a passage of Scripture over in the New Testament, because it says, Peter writes, that if he, or God, rescued Lot, a righteous man, who was distressed by the depraved conduct of the lawless, for that righteous man, living among them day by day, was tormented in his righteous soul by the lawless deeds they saw and heard. Three times in two verses it says what? He's a righteous man. So he's a good man. But good men, like all of us, we have our flaws. And Lot had them. Now, flaws are part of nature, but we have to work on them, because if we don't, they'll come back to haunt us and cause possibly great sorrow and damage to our lives and to those about us. And what we're going to find out is these flaws began to emerge in Lot's life at this point. So they're in this conflict. And so Abram said to Lot, let's not have any quarreling between you and me, or between your herdsmen and mine, for we're brothers. Is not the whole land before you? Let's part company. You go left, I'll go right. You go right, I'll go left. Now, they're in the middle of the land at this point, and they're on a high ridge, and they have a panoramic view of much of the land of promise. And they seemingly, I think it's safe to say, they're oriented, they're looking east. And so what Abram is offering is actually a very fair and an equitable offer to solve the problem. What he's simply saying is, we'll just divide the land in the middle. If you go north, I'll go south. You go south, what? I'll go north. Fair. Let's do this. However, the Bible says that Lot looked up and he saw that the whole plain of the Jordan was well watered, like the garden of the Lord, like the land of Egypt, toward Zoar. This was before the Lord destroyed off Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, he's standing east. Now, the Jordan River would become the eastern boundary of the land of promise. And during the rainy season, the Jordan Valley would be flooded. Thus, that valley was beautiful, well-watered, and luscious, like the Garden of the Lord, meaning the Garden of Eden. you go back to Genesis, you find there were four streams of water that kept the land watered. And also he says, like Egypt. Well, Egypt, of course, was flooded by regular irrigation from the flooding of the Nile River. Now, he's looking at that, and this is where his law comes in. Law becomes, he becomes a selfish man. He disrespects his uncle. Because you would think, I'm not going to do that. I respect and honor you too much. Now, he's just thinking, he offered, and I took it. But no, he has no thoughts of doing that because, you see, he's got my problems. What I want, I'm going to take. And I'll leave you hanging if I need to because I want what I want. And he was willing to turn his back on his uncle and said, I want what I want and I'm going to take it. And so he parts ways with his uncle, packs everything together, goes down in the valley. And the Bible says something about the valley. It says that before the Lord destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, so he chose for himself the whole plain of the Jordan and set out toward the east. The two men parted company. Abram lived in the land of Canaan, while Laban lived among the cities of the plain. And he pitched his tent near Sodom. Now the men of Sodom were wicked, and they were sinning greatly against the Lord. Now, he saw this bird of the green valley, and he went down to where the green grass grows. And he's beginning to say, this is good. But in his self-centered mode, either he chose to ignore what was going on there, or he didn't know about it when he got there. But either way, it was obvious what was going on in that valley. But he says, that's just the price of doing business. I've got to take care of my wife. I've got to take care of my family. This is the place. But not only is he self-centered, he's short-sighted. Because you see, he's willing to make a choice without really carefully considering the implications and the consequences of the decision that he's getting ready to make and has made. And quickly, he goes down into that valley, and all the sinfulness is all about him. And he just keeps right on living. He's becoming self-centered. He's becoming short-sighted. Now, the reason I say that is because I think I can prove that by Scripture, what's happening in his life. Let me read a couple more passages to you. Because the Bible says, he lived near Sodom, but in 14:12, it says that they also carried off Abram's nephew, Lot, and his possessions. Excuse me. Problem times sneezing and nasal tube drainage. Oh, sorry, me. It says they also carried off Abram's nephew Lot and his possessions, since he was living in Sodom. Now, here's what happened: war breaks out in that region in the valley, and Sodom is overrun, it's looted, and all of its citizens are captured and taken captives of war. But did you notice something? He is a part of them because he's now living in Sodom. First he looked toward the east, and then he moved there, near there, and then he's living in the city. But see, it happens so gradually that he doesn't really perceive what's going on. He's selfish. I gotta do this for myself. I gotta take care. I don't see the consequences of what's happening, but here's what's going on. Let me give you another passage of Scripture, chapter 19. With the coming of the dawn, in chapter 19, two angels arrived at Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gateway of the city. And when he saw them, he got up to meet them and bowed down his face to the ground. My lords, he said, please turn aside to your servant's house. You can wash your feet and spend the night and then go on your way in the morning. No, they answered, we'll spend the night where? But he insisted so strongly that they did go with him and entered his house. Did you notice something? He goes first to into the valley with his tents, goes near Sodom, and then goes in Sodom. And now he has saved up his money And he's built a house in the suburbs of Sodom. Another opportunity to better oneself. But not only has he moved in Sodom, built a house in Sodom, he's rubbing shoulders with the right kind of people. Because the Bible says he's sitting at the gateway of the city. Officials, magistrates of cities, sit at gateways of the city so that the townsfolk could come out and have their cases heard or decisions rendered about something that's going on in the city life. Lot has left his nomadic lifestyle to become a city dweller, and not only that, he's gotten him a seat on the city council. A magistrate, some people suspect that that word may be interpreted that he would become the mayor of the city. I don't know if we push it that far, but he's got his seat. You don't get those kind of positions without rubbing shoulders with influential people and having personal ambitions of your own to move up. Lot's become enmeshed in the life there with himself and with his family. He's become self-centered. He's become short-sighted. But he's failed to perceive his failures. He's failed to perceive what it's doing to himself and what it's doing to his family. Because you see, he's become numb to the world about him. He's saying, well, I can do this. I can go on about my life. And I can make it. I can do well. But he failed to understand what it was doing to him, and as we should see, what the implications that it would have on his family. Let me tell you what happened. Number one, Lot begins to lose his influence. Because you see, as men of faith, we're to have an influence on those who are about us, about Jesus, about Christ. In the Old Testament, faith in God. But here's what happened. The angels arrive in Sodom as messengers from God to confirm the wickedness of Sodom. And boy, they see it in spades. It's not pleasant, but here's what happened. Lot brings them into his home, feeds them a meal. They're sitting around getting ready for bed. You know, they're just talking. What's happened is, men, the Bible tells us, from all over the city, young, middle-aged, and old, have gathered together. They've heard that Lot is entertaining male guests. And they knock on the door. Lot goes out and he says, we'd like for you to send those two men out that you have there, and we won't have our way with them. Well, they keep pressing, to the extent that the angels reach out and grab Lot and bring him back inside and strike the men blind. That's it. The angel says, Lot, get your family together out here. You can't stay. And also, if you've got any relatives, if you've got any extended family, get them also and bring them here because we've got to go. Now, here's where he loses his influence. Listen to what it says. Lot went out and spoke to his sons-in-law who were pledged to be married to his daughter. Get that? Not only is he losing the influence of his life, he's making decisions that lead to the downfall of his own family. Because you see, he has chosen wives, or husbands, for his daughters, men of the city. Of course, the implications are that they would marry, that they would settle down where? In the city, have a family, right there in the open sewer of that land. What kind of decision is that? He's lost his influence. Making poor decisions for his family. Now, not only that, let me go on. It says that he went out and spoke to his sons-in-law and blessed me and his daughters. He said, hurry, get out of this place because the Lord's about to destroy the city. But his sons-in-law thought he was only joking. Now, as I wrestled with this passage, I tried to determine, is it speaking more about the sons-in-law or about Lot? Are these two sons-in-laws so stubborn and obstinate that they don't listen to sound advice? Or has Lot become such a non-factor? He has no influence that when he turns on his God talk, that the sons just ignored him. Well, you're joking. You're not serious. You decide which one it was, but it really doesn't matter because it didn't work. Because they thought he was joking. Well, that's it. The Bible says he's lost his influence. He's getting ready. He should go reflect something. He's lost his leadership. Listen, when the morning of dawn, when the morning coming of the dawn, the angels urged Lot, hurry, take your wife and your two daughters over here, or you'll be swept away when the city is punished. And when he hesitated, the men grasped his hands and the hands of his wife and his two daughters, and they led them out of the city. The Lord was merciful to them. He's paralyzed. He's about to lose everything that he worked for all his life. And now he's being told to leave the city. He can't do it. When he should have manned up and turned to his wife and his family and says, we've got to get out of here. We need to go to safety. It's time to walk away from this place. Can't do it. He's lost his influence. He's lost his leadership ability to take care of his family. And the angels have to literally grab him by the hands and take him out of the city to safety. He loses his influence, he loses his leadership, but it's not over. Part of the instructions of the angel is when you leave the city, don't look back. Why? If you look back, you see the whole valley going up in smoke, perhaps even your own home going up in flames. And if you look back, all those emotions of what you had will overwhelm you. Don't be tied to the past. Get away from it. Leave it. Because you know it couldn't happen because the Bible says that Lot's wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. He lost his wife. And I'm going to tell you something, folks. I need to tell you. He didn't lose his wife there. He lost his wife a long time ago. He lost his wife when he allowed the city of Sodom and all of the lifestyle going on there to become so overwhelming to himself and his family and his wife that they couldn't walk away from the city and leave it. And she had to look back. And he lost his wife. Apparently, you can take the wife out of the city, but you can't want to take the city out of the wife. But folks, it's not over. He finally, he and his two daughters now make it, they escape. And they finally end up in the mountains, in a cave. He's lost it all. No neighbors, no friends. He is estranged. He's in an alien land. And they're alone, with nothing. Later, his daughters are talking together and they're discussing their grim circumstances. And they're looking around. This is it. We have lost everything. We lost our mom. We lost our home. All our dreams and the hopes and wishes are dashed. We lost our mates. We got nothing. And this is where it's going to end. We're going to die here. And no one will ever know that we lived. Our family line will stop right here. And so they offer this as an excuse for what they're about to do. The older daughter says to the younger, tell you what, I'm going to sleep with Dad tonight. And then you go in the next, and you sleep with him. Perhaps we can have children by our father and we'll preserve our family line. How in the world could you stoop to such perversity? Where'd they get, well, they got a back saw. You can take the daughter out of the city, but you can't take the city one and the daughter. He's lost his influence, he's lost his leadership, he's lost his wife, and he's losing his daughter. But he's lost his own integrity. Because you see, his daughters know their dad. they know that they can supply him enough alcohol that he will drink himself into a stupor. And he did it not once, but twice. First time, shame on you. Second time, what? Shame on me. The Bible says in 1933, he was not aware of it. When she lay down and when she got up, that's his older daughter. In 35, again, he was not aware of it. When he lay down and when she got up, he's lost it. Now, people, he was a good man. But he began making some poor decisions. And the house that he tried to build, he began to cut corners. And he papered over the shoddy workmanship of his home. And when the storm came, it crumbled. But I think we'll have to be honest, and we see it today. They're good individuals and need good families. And they start out well. They have a strong faith. They have a commitment to a local church. But what happens, as life progresses, they get busy. And they begin moving in the right social circles. They begin to progress economically and socially. And it just becomes really difficult to maintain a faith in Christ and a commitment to the church when you got all these things to do. I've got to go here. I've got to go there. My kids are involved in all of these activities. We just can't be there as much as we'd like to be there. It doesn't happen overnight. It happens by degrees. When we just allow ourselves to become numb to what's happening. Now, please, though, don't misunderstand what I'm saying. There's nothing wrong with moving in and moving up. But you can't do it to the sacrifice of your faith. You can't do it and say, Lord, I'm sorry, but I can't be as committed to you as I'd like to be because of all the stuff I've got going on in my life. When it gets too much, what gets jettisoned is not God. It's things that don't matter, that don't go into building a house. You see, we've got to make some decisions in where we're trending. And we've got to ask ourselves, am I going to be where I want to be if I keep going where I'm going? And will I want to live in the house that I'm building? Will I be satisfied where I am? Is it what I'm looking for? Is it what I'm hoping for? Is it what I'm praying for? Or perhaps do I need to step back and say, wait a minute, we're trending in the wrong direction. We're making some decisions that's compromising our faith. We're building some things into our home that's having an effect on me, and it's having an effect on my family, on my children, and we can't do this anymore. We've got to sit down and decide what direction we're going, and if we're going to be satisfied once we get there. Because, folks, I think we all know we don't get one shot at this. And if we end up where we don't want to be, then we'll be like God. And I think any of us want to end up in a cave. None of us want to be alone. None of us want to be separated. None of us want to be broken. None of us want to be living with regret. None of us want to be doing the things that Lot was doing when he was in that cave. And the only way to do it is to back way, way up and says, now, wait a minute. I don't want to be selfish. I want to do the very best that I can in life. But I don't want to be so short-sighted that I fail to perceive the implications of the decision that I'm about to make for myself and for my family. Because I want to build a home where Christ is honored. I want to build a home where the church gets first place in everything that I do and in everything I live for. Because in the end, it's not there. It hasn't been worth it. It's my encouragement that perhaps some of you, it might be that you need to have a conversation this week. Just reflect. It may be that after you reflect, you can check out, yep, we're doing it, doing it. It may be, you say, you know what, we need to maybe rethink some of the decisions that we're making here. We might want to reflect on what we're doing, because I'm not sure that I want to go where I'm going. And I'm not sure I'm going to like where I end up if I keep going in this direction. And it's my prayer right now that we would, if we need to do that, we'll do it. Father in heaven, I thank you for the testimony of this man. It was tough because he began a good man. But he began making some decisions, Father, that came back to haunt him. And he lost more than he ever gained. And I pray right now that we would take his example and apply it to each of our lives. And if there's any decisions that we need to make, if there's any actions that we need to take, if there's something that we need to do to put ourselves and orient ourselves in the right direction, that we'll do it before it's too late. But one thing we always know, Heavenly Father, that your grace is sufficient. You took Lot's hands when he couldn't take them himself because you're merciful and you led him to safety. And you'll do that for us, Heavenly Father, if we'll just allow you. So I pray right now for your grace and your mercy on us all, because we're all frail. We all fail. So help us to be strong in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Perhaps you're here, and if maybe something I've said, or maybe the Lord is prompting you to go home this week and say, let's just renew what we are. Or it may be that you need to come forward and just pray. It may be that you say, I need a church home to encourage me to walk faith. And I want to be strong. I want to know that where I'm going and where I'm going to go. If God is building something in your heart right this moment, then never be afraid to. Don't turn aside from what he's saying to God right now, because he's making a meaningful decision for you and your family, perhaps, and you will not regret it. So let's stand and we'll sing this wonderful song, Marvelous Grace, of our loving grace, greater than our sin.